Hello! This year's podcast has been brought to you by Cine.nl. This must you see.
Will you please listen up to what I have to say? Cause we're in for some old-fashioned wrestling today. Not the vile and oily opposer of each kind, but the kind that involves pins and thumbs you will find. Cause it's thumb wrestling time.
Yes, it's thumb wrestling time.
Yes, it's thumb wrestling time. So we will discuss pros and cons, faults and pluses of all your favorite movies. And we will ponder the merits of cinema in this WrestleMania. Cause it's thumb wrestling time.
Yes, it's thumb wrestling time.
Yes, it's thumb wrestling time. Yes, it's thumb wrestling time.
That is true. It is thumb wrestling time. Hello, pot people.
Wow.
That is from Invasion of the Body Snatchers. Welcome to a brand new episode of Thumb Wrestling, the show in which I, Ruud Vos, will speak with a certain guest about a film that we disagree on. And here we are at episode car 54. Where are you? Episode 54. Yes, the Studio 54 movie. Mike Myers' finest hour. We have a great show in store for you with quite an esteemed guest. You might know him as the voice of Donald Trump in the Netherlands Second video that he made for the show of Arjen Lubach, Zondag met Lubach. I originally know him as the news anchor in Comedy Central News in the 2000s. It is Mr. Greg Shapiro, one of the original founders of the theater Boom Chicago on the Rozengracht in Amsterdam. These days he mostly performs a solo theater show called Leaving Trumpland, and he will be in Nijmegen on Sunday the 7th of March, at least if the lockdown is lifted by then, and that will be in the Tiemelodes. In the meantime, you can watch his YouTube channel, The United States of Europe, his own take on the news here in Europe from the perspective of an American, and of course his new book, The American Netherlander, which is in stores now. I spoke with Greg on the 24th of January. He would have been in Nijmegen then, but yes, that's a performance that was delayed due to the circumstances, which are obvious. So we talked via Skype, and we had a great chat about the Lego movie, a film that I wasn't looking forward to back in the day, but then it got an amazing response. So I thought, well, let's give it a try, and then it did disappoint me in the end. Greg, however, is a big fan. And the Lego movie is, of course, a animation film by directors Phil Lord and Christopher Miller. It contains voice work of such talented actors as Chris Pratt and Elizabeth Banks and, of course, Morgan Freeman. And Will Ferrell is in there as well. And it is the story of Emmet, a Lego character that is the most generic of all Lego characters, and he's kind of as dumb as a bag of bricks. He discovers, however, by accident, that he might be the special, the one character that might save all of the Lego world. Egged on by a blind wizard called Vetruvius and also inspired by his budding love for a female rebel called Wyldstyle, he endeavors to defeat Lord Business, the big baddie in this film. In the end, it turns out, however, that this is all a metaphor for how do you want to play with Legos? Do you want to follow the instructions or do you want to go freestyle and be creative all by yourself? So this could very well have been just a very long Lego commercial, but I have to give it that it was a bit more than that. Why dislike it then? Well, you'll find out right after this.
Show me the money.
Thumb Wrestling is, of course, a free podcast, and it will always remain a free podcast. That doesn't mean we can't use a bit of financial support making this. For instance, the server room that we put the podcast on isn't free, and neither is the software to use to edit it. So for a tiny amount each month, you can give us financial support, and you get benefits for doing so. For instance, bonus material that hasn't made it into the regular episodes, and you get early access to each episode. So, if you want to help out, please visit patreon.com/duimpjeworsteler. And now, let's head over to my conversation with Greg Shapiro about the Lego movie.
3, 2, 1, fight!
You saw Lego Movie on the list, right, that I sent you?
Yes.
And you immediately tuned into that.
I did. Wait, are we starting already?
If you want to. If you don't want to, then we can ease into it more.
Oh, no, that's fine. in fact, a moment about how we had planned to meet in person, and then that wasn't possible because of Corona, and I was supposed to be performing in Nijmegen today.
Yes.
Thank you for at least having this kind of creative audience speaking to some kind of audience. It's great. And for the record, that show in Nijmegen, they're not giving up. So
I know.
I rescheduled it once. Now they've forgotten. They said, forget about February. We'll just assume that's all locked down. And now there is some date in March coming up.
Yeah.
So indeed, I'll still hope to see you at the show in March.
I'll put the date in the show notes and my introduction to the conversation.
Good. And also I'm here to promote my book, so I hear it's quite funny. Here it is. Ta-da. So it's big size. It's nice. Feels good in your hand. I'm really happy how it came out. So The American Netherlander, 25 years of expat tales.
Yes, you've had more books out, right?
Yeah, I had one book in 2013 called How to Be Orange and one in 2016, which was How to Be Dutch. That's just the quiz version. So with the new book, I've kind of combined some of the best of the first two books and added some stuff for the third. So this time we got it right.
Third time's a charm.
Yeah. Yeah. Back to the list that you sent me with what you've sent me, films you loved and films that you
didn't like. Or at least which were disappointing to me in some way. And I would say that the Lego Movie is actually one that I'm not very much not fond of, but you made it clear in your email back to me that I'm not allowed to dislike the Lego Movie.
There's a certain category of film that you're not allowed to not like. I suppose Lego Movie is not among them. There are more like movies with a more political, sociio-political context, like Black Panther. You're not allowed to not like Black Panther.
I've heard loads of people who thought it was a very mediocre superhero movie. You don't like Black Panther because of that.
Yeah. I mean, I didn't hate it. the whole MCU, Marvel Comics and stuff. And I grew up with that too. They're really well done, actually.
Yeah.
But it's not like I want to go back and watch them again and again. And I'm not a huge film buff, I must say, in general.
That's fine.
So this
that's
is
great.
As in-depth as I get, I suppose.
That's cool.
But back to the film releases.
We don't need to get into it too deep. I'll do some of the trivia stuff because that's just my jam.
Yeah.
But let's just hang out and talk about movies. That's just cool, right? But you said I'm not allowed to not like the Lego Movie, which is I'm not going to say that I took that very seriously, but there is a thing in there where it's not supposed to be high culture or anything.
No.
And I do feel like I'm a bit of a grouch by going into this.
Well,
maybe more criticism than is necessary.
And there's always expectation management. But I guess this movie for me, when it came out and it was 2014, I've had, kids. My daughter was born in 2000 and my son was born in 2004. So they were at an age where I had already seen a lot of brand exploitation, whatever, cash grabs.
Yeah.
Barbie series came to mind with bad
the straight to DVD Barbie
graphics.
Series
exactly. And
I used to work in a video store and my boss, he long resisted buying them, but once he bought them the girls just kept on renting them, so he said no, my mistake, I should have gotten them earlier.
Playmobil also I'm not sure if that was before or after.
It was after.
Lego. I mean, if you're Playmobil, how could you let Lego movie achieve that in cinema? And whatever, the Emoji Movie, my son also pointed out, like...
That's one of the biggest dumpster fires, according to people who have seen it. And I've never seen it either.
No, and maybe you have to just because it's such a fiasco. But anyway, son was saying that this you'd have every reason to expect that the Lego movie would just be, you know, a pleasant time waster at best. And I guess also, you know, maybe personally... it took me watching the Lego movie to realize that I spent a lot of time playing with Legos when I was a kid. And Legos have been, you know, part of my life, you know, being a father as well. So since I got to see the movie, like from both perspectives, it worked on a number of levels for me way more than I thought it would.
Have you threatened your children with crazy glue yet?
You know, no, nothing that literal, but, you know, have I pulled some Will Ferrell, you know, like Lord Business or, some moves about trying to introduce a bit more control and order into the chaos? Sure, I've done that.
I asked you for a mini review of the film. You sent it to me beforehand. Yeah. I didn't read it because I like to prepare my own stories, but I also like to be surprised by my guests.
Uh-huh.
So what did you write in it?
I think I have that here. No, not there. But so, yes, I wrote a mini review of the Lego movie, which is... The Lego movie had every right to be as bland a disappointment as the Barbie Nutcracker. But luckily, it was hilarious. Who knew that Morgan Freeman and Liam Neeson could get so many laughs by playing against their normal type? And the big twist was so clever that I got yelled at for laughing so hard in a cinema in Amsterdam.
So, as the twist, what do you mean, the crazy glue part, or the what it's about?
The whole movie has a Matrix layover, and honestly, the retelling of this retelling of the Matrix maybe pays off the philosophical underpinnings of the Matrix better than the Matrix. But they're talking about
certainly than the sequels.
Yeah, right. yes. But the man upstairs, you know, and the creator or the architect or whatever. Yeah. And when the movie switches from animated to live action, that is my, that's what I mean by the big twist.
Yeah.
And when the father, when Will Ferrell literally says, you know the rules, this isn't a toy. It's an interlocking brick system.
When I saw this movie for the first time,
I was there with my kids and laughing. And then this Dutch couple in front of me turned around and they were like, shh. They laughed even harder. Like, do you not even get your being Lord Business right now? it is possible to laugh too hard. That is true. I took my kids to watch Toy Story 4. Yeah. And then I knew that Jordan Peele and Keegan-Michael Key had a cameo role. A pair of toys.
Yes.
And I didn't know what it was exactly. And I mean, hey, I used to work with Jordan Peele, who started his career in Amsterdam. So, yes, was there maybe an extra bit of oomph in my laughter when they pulled out their, you know, totally Key and Peele fantasy sequences that were perfectly animated by Pixar? Like, oh my God, I got such a kick out of that. And indeed, I got shushed then as well. And that might have been justified, indeed. Yeah.
Yeah, well, all right. Fair enough. But you were saying about the Lego movie that it is that just makes you laugh so much.
Yeah.
That's I wouldn't say a criticism. It's just my personal thing with it is that it doesn't tickle me in the same way that it does other people. Like, I don't laugh as much about this film as other. And I've because of that, I started noticing all kinds of things why I think it's not funny, but sort of a chicken and the egg thing. Like, is it that I'm not laughing because I'm seeing the joke logic too many times and it doesn't work for me?
Okay.
Or am I not laughing and thereby noticing things in joke logic that I wouldn't have noticed otherwise, which I would have discarded anyway if I would have been laughing anyway?
Certainly, I'm not here to convince you. You know, we can have a bigger conversation about how everyone experiences every artwork differently based on the, you know, lifetime sum of artworks you've seen, and even just the most recent five movies or any kind of artworks, you know, that you've seen. And then, you know, the expectations that creates going into the way you consume, you know, a film or experience that story or the jokes or whatever. Whatever happened with me, it seemed to be a pleasantly nice combination of factors the silly, goofy inner child jokes, like bad sound effects, bad special effects.
Stuff like that I really liked about it.
Because it's a kid playing.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah, exactly. The ship going.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. right, of course. It's
Stuff like that is wonderful.
That was, just made me crack up in a, like a little kid. And I felt, Team America is another one that I can't stand behind on the whole as a film, but just having that style of animation, those dumb mannequins acting out action sequences with these stupid puppets.
Spoofing Michael Bay movies.
Right.
Maybe not from a position of love for them. They clearly...
Yeah.
Say that they don't like Michael Bay movies in Team America.
Okay. Oh, interesting. Yeah. Oh, God, like, it's been a while.
They have a song in there, Michael Bay Sucks.
Oh, really?
But I Love You.
Oh, okay. Oh, I forgot that. Yeah. A couple of Michael Bay references maybe in Lego Movie as well. Like when Old West bad guys fall off a cliff and then, you know, we wait until they hit the bottom and then huge explosion. Sorry, what was exploding in the Old West? Like, okay, but fine. I'm sure there was some gasoline bomb hidden in there somewhere. That seems to be a nod to the, again, our expectations as film viewers. Yeah. Ha ha ha.
I'm Brian, and so is this podcast.
I know why, part of why I don't like it, and it has to do with the pair who directed the film, Phil Lord and
Miller?
Lord and Miller.
Okay, yeah, I don't know much about them actually.
They also did 21 Jump Street.
Oh, really?
The movie with Channing Tatum and Jonah Hill, and also the sequel, the reboot. 22 Jump Street.
Oh, God.
And
okay.
I also didn't like that very much, so I think it's very much a thing with their style. But don't dislike every project they've worked on. They've also been producing capacity at the television show The Last Man on Earth with Will Forte.
Right, yeah. Yeah. No, I know Elizabeth Cassidy like used to write on it.
Yeah.
I haven't seen it so much.
And they worked on Spider-Verse, Spider-Man animation, which I really
liked.
Yeah,
we like that one. Yeah, yeah.
One of them was a credited writer on that, and I think the other one was also a producer.
Mm-hmm.
But not a writer.
So wait, they are a directing pair?
Yeah.
Because like the Matrix and the Wachowskis, I mean, plural, that's fairly unique.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And they were going to direct and had directed a large portion of Solo before they were fired off the project, and then Ron Howard took over to fix the movie.
Oh, right.
According to rumors, they sort of made it an Ace Ventura in space.
Oof.
Which the Disney Corporation did not like, and so they were taken off.
Yeah.
All fairness, even though I don't like the movies they've directed, I would have liked to see that. I think I'm going to like it just for curiosity's sake. I do know that they have a lot of craft. I just know that they don't tickle me as much.
Yeah,
but I'm
yeah.
still very curious for what they make.
At some point, you'll probably be able to go see the Lord and Miller version of Solo, the movie.
Release the Lord and Miller cut.
Yeah, right.
That's
how
the internet works these days.
Yeah, weird. I did not know. I was around for the original 21 Jump Street. That's how old I am.
I remember watching it. My older brother watched it. I sometimes watched along a bit. But yes, that's how I know Johnny Depp.
Johnny Depp was on that show, right? Yeah. That was his claim to fame, or that was his like big break, I guess.
And then he tried to not get stuck in that role as a teenage heartthrob by doing stuff like Edward Scissorhands and Crybaby.
Yeah, which made it even worse, actually.
Crybaby did, at least, yeah.
Yeah.
Scissorhands, definitely.
Oh, yeah. No, my little sister was, you know, yeah. That really worked for her. But anyway, I spent a lot of time building Legos. And I think Lauren Michaels had a quote about on Mark Maron podcast.
Yeah.
If everyone comes up to Lauren Michaels and says, Saturday Night Live, why isn't it funny anymore?
Yeah.
He will ask them, when was the last time it was funny?
Yeah.
And he said, depending on your answer, he knows exactly when you went to high school. And then, you know, for me, it was before high school. Actually, I was watching this first episodes, but, you know, in 1975. Because I'm from 68. And so, you know, 75 was kind of peak, you know, late night TV watching for me. And in the Midwest, it was on at 10:30 instead of 11:30.
So you're a Chevy Chase ad?
Chevy Chase, golly. Yeah, I got into more like John Belushi, Bill Murray, and Dan Aykroyd. But Gilda Radner, oh, what an inspiration. She, you could do anything. You could say anything. It was so liberating. And then the idea that they came from this theater in Chicago, and that I could go there and learn from there. So I did. But back to Lego. You know, there's so many in the Lego movie, they do, I guess, you know, part of the job is you have to do a certain amount of justice to the different realms, whether it's, you know, Lego City or Pirate Island or space or whatever. I mean, and space was my thing back when Star Wars came out in 77. And then came the, you know, Lego space sets, but that's when everything was trying to be like space. Let's do space. And of course there wasn't any like licensing or tie-ins at that point. Every kid was just trying to make a, but I literally had, you know, master builder moment, when I was growing up that, you know, after getting enough kits and building the kits according to the instructions, there was a builder's convention or something for, you know, Lego fans. And it was your chance. No one used the term master builder, but I mean, your own designs.
They actually do use the word master builder. It's an official Lego term for people who make their own like sculptures and stuff with Legos.
Sure. And and I mean,
they didn't do that when you went there when you were a kid, but
I don't think, I can't remember, but I do remember making something that was, you know, my version of Battlestar Galactica, Star Wars something, and just as big as possible with all these extra little doodads popping out of it, you know, not very aerodynamic. Yeah, well, there's no air in space, Dad. And so anyway, there was a prize. I was led to believe I might win some prize, but like, of course I was disappointed. And the one who did win, I remember, was a design that was a lot like some, you know, something you might see in a box of Legos, like a proper from Denmark Lego design. Yeah. And I guess I kind of thought like, oh, now I know what they were after. But in a way,
they want to get a new design that they could market.
Maybe. Why not? I guess. Yeah. Although the stupid thing about Lego the movie was that at some point, everyone can be special. Everyone can be a master builder. And you should build your own like cuckoo crazy designs, like make a flying garbage truck. Why not? And then the marketing like tie-ins, the Lego movie box sets where you're, you know, where you could like build the flying garbage truck you saw in the Lego movie. That offended me.
Wow.
Just because I'm now the parent that, you know, now I saw my young self at that building contest from my parents' perspective. Like, there's just no design consistency to that flying garbage truck. It's an abomination.
You've been formed a bit too much by Adolf's life by this time. You've been shaped into a...
Make it at least nice to look at. These things are like deliberately ugly. But yeah, that was the point. So anyway, I do feel bad for kids who just started out collecting Legos when these were the first sets coming out.
You voice a bit of criticism there, but I would say that maybe my criticism of the Lego movie in that point would be more that for a movie that tries to celebrate creativity, like stepping out of the mold, the instructions and stuff like that, it doesn't really get that creative. It could go way more over the top.
Okay. No, that is true.
Because you do have Cloud Cuckoo Land, which kind of goes there, but it's just a bunch of white clouds like a head in space, and I guess what they're trying to make of that, but it's just that there are loads of random figures there.
Yeah, way too many. In fact, it seems like, well, we got to pay off, you know, the DC universe. We got to pay off Shakespeare and all the, you know, like, oh, okay, it's Dumbledore and Gandalf. Oh, let's have you know, they get confused, mixed up. Great. And there are some funny jokes, but there's almost, indeed, there's too much going on. It's too dense. And, then we have the moment state your bias. I'm not only someone who collected Legos and played with Legos on a competitive basis at one point.
Yeah. Okay.
But I've never used that term to describe myself before. But an improviser, I come from comedy improv, and actually I started out studying theater where improv was like, that's what goof-offs do. And then I learned like, oh, those are the people who make the money. So I'll do that and have fun while I'm doing it. But there is definitely a sense of camaraderie and a sense of, everyone can be special. When you're improvising, and yet there's that moment in Cloud Cuckoo Land in the Lego movie where let's put all the master builders together. Everyone is equal. Let's make a submarine that quickly leaks and sinks because, what do you know, they don't. You know, with pure improv and no leadership or guidance, then that's also bad.
Yeah, you do need some constraints, but within these constraints, you can be at your most creative.
Yeah, and
that's supposed to be how it works, right?
I guess, indeed. And having a blueprint or some design is maybe not so bad.
There's one criticism that I at least want to voice because I wanted to pay off in the end. And it's about, there is a bit of story logic in there that also doesn't really work for me. I guess I know why it is like it is, like the way the story goes in the fictional Lego world. But it's all supposed to sort of take place in the boy's head, right?
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
So he's
making
up a story in the Lego Movie Part 2, which I also watch in preparation.
I haven't seen all of that yet. Okay, sorry.
He's working on a narrative in that movie. He says it out loud, but then he's also he's a teenage boy, so it's different. It's natural that he talks about it that way. But still, in this one, it's supposed to take place in his head.
Okay.
But part of the master plan of Lord Business is something that isn't in his head, it's in his dad's head. So the story is formed basically by the two of them. Even though parts of the story are connected to stuff in the boy's life, like Cloud Cuckoo Land is his own box of Legos that he's got for himself.
Right, that's true, yeah. Yeah.
It's sort of thought out, but it's not completely thought out. And you start noticing these things when you're not as entertained by the jokes, I think.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, or you go back and you watch things you missed from the Lego movie or film theory about the Lego movie. But everything wrong with,
May the force be with you.
But there is plenty of stuff in it that I really do like. The song Everything is Awesome.
Mark Mothersbaugh.
Yeah, and...
he was in Devo.
Yeah, Mark Mothersbaugh. He did the music for the first couple of films of Wes Anderson, which I also really dig.
Oh, yeah. No, he did the
soundtrack for Thor Ragnarok, which is also one of the best.
Isn't that nuts? Oh, yeah. My God, yeah. No, Mark Mothersbaugh is one of the great modern film composers like Danny Elfman.
Yeah, and the guys from Nine Inch Nails, Trent Reznor and Ross Atticus.
That's amazing as well. What did Trent Reznor just do? That I was like, oh, that was Trent Reznor.
Soul,
yeah. Oh, Soul. I saw the preview and I was prepared to not be impressed. Yeah. But again, wowzers. Anyway.
And also Mank, which is also a very off-brand for them.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Yeah. Well, fair enough. Well, sorry. We talked
about Mark Mothersbaugh, yeah.
And so, sorry, you were saying you did like some things about the film and the soundtrack.
I like most of the talent in there. I like that Will Arnett, whom I'm a big fan of because of BoJack Horseman, is also Batman in this, which is a very good fit.
But I
do have to say that I didn't laugh at his jokes. I get what he's doing, but...
Yeah. I ended up watching Batman, the Lego Batman movie.
Yeah, I preferred that.
I don't know how I had... Oh, sorry, you like that better than Lego movie? Okay. Yeah. Although, then the jokes, well, whatever. I don't know. Some of the jokes were, I guess, okay in, I don't know. Just some of the storytelling. They're like, oh, what are you expecting? A hyperdrive to pop up? What? Again? How does this?
Yeah.
fine. If you have to shoehorn.
Hey, those are a plot twist. Shortcuts. They're fine.
Yeah. Anyway, that the.
Do you know Father Ted?
I know, of the series,
They have this one episode where Father Ted is becoming worried that people think that he's a fascist.
Oh.
And it starts off when there's, on his window, there's this very square piece of, it's not the start of it, but it's part of it, that there's a very square piece of dirt. And when he's invited the Chinese over to convince them that he's not a fascist, he stands right in front of the square piece of dirt and looks like a Hitler mustache. At the very start of the episode, the house cleaner, she says, that's a very oddly square piece of dirt there.
Yeah.
And it's a comedy shortcut for a joke.
Right, yeah. And, I mean, do you ever...
If they make it that obvious, then I have to be sort of awed at what the lengths they're going to.
Selected placement, that they, or whatever they call it, and selected appearance. Sometimes in retrospect, you can ferret out the joke that started the entire project. This whole episode. Don't mention the war. I don't know. So wait a minute. Other things that you liked. Oh, you know what? In rewatching the film, I guess I had forgotten about the depiction of the subconscious. It was actually pretty good. I think of an object or I imagine a thing and then you get to see it, you know, popping up out of, Lego bricks, but...
Just
sort of...
Where you see the hand.
Transparent, Lego bricks. Like proto brick. And the big human hand comes out of there. I guess that reminded me of Minecraft as well.
Oh, yeah.
And the way that... I guess Lego and Minecraft share a lot. I mean, Minecraft is a lot like digital Lego. Mm-hmm. It's got a survival mode, and that's, you know, fine for video games. But it seems like the staying power of Minecraft is indeed what people can make. It's much easier in Minecraft, indeed, to build something and then invite everybody, you know, from around the world to see it or hang out in it. What you could do with Lego, I suppose. There's even that guy, the designer, the artist called The Art of the Brick. I used to be a Wall Street lawyer and now I, took over as a Lego and now I make artworks out of Lego. And he started off, I guess, imitating or recreating, famous artworks and then started making his own thing.
And he even recreated the book title of Donald Trump. Out of the deal into the art of the brick. That's what it sounds like to me.
Oh, that's true.
If you used to be a businessman, it's quite apt.
Oh, that is, yeah. Oh, wow.
The Art of the Brick, the best art exhibition ever. Totally great. It's like the Bible of art.
There favorite. He is. I made a special point of not asking you for that impression, but but it seeped in there anyway because I noticed the book title.
Oh, yeah. It's totally great, the best. And I saw it in the Netherlands first. somewhere else was second. I just like the idea that some people still, as adults, find a use for Lego, for modeling, or for, you know, their careers. I guess funny story about my brother, who works in L.A., in a production company with Elijah Wood and Josh Waller.
Yeah, I think you
mentioned
I once put a post on Facebook when I got to do an introduction for the film Mandy, and I thought, I think you mentioned it then that you have a brother who's in film production.
He was one of the producers on the Nicolas Cage film Mandy.
Yeah.
And
it's an excellent film. Have you seen it?
I have, a couple times. It's out there, you know.
It's very much out there.
And so with a friend of mine who does like a good story and kind of a, you know, formulaic storytelling, not to his taste, but yeah, to me, I've seen so many other versions of that genre that the fact that it deliberately took so many odd twists felt like, okay, I'm ready for that. The story about my brother with, you know, childhood experiences that go on and inform your career. My brother studied screenwriting and, went out to LA to start doing that. So this is when he bumped into a friend of his from childhood. And I think hadn't seen each other for years. And my brother said, you know, I was just thinking about you the other day because so much of what we used to do on Saturdays, you know, just spending hours of, live role playing, with these Star Wars action figures. And we would create whole new scenarios and stories. And I guess I used that experience to inform what I do for work today, which is, Hollywood screenwriter. And his friend said, oh my God, that's so funny. I have the same experience. And my brother said, like, oh wow, what do you do for work now? And the friend said, yeah, I buy and sell 70s Star Wars action figures. So living for work.
Oh yeah.
And he's made better money doing that. So you went briefly to politics.
Right.
Or at least, you know, the greatest voice. And so we're at the point now where Trump is finally out the door.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's really interesting at this moment just to look back on how much of Trump and how much of Trumpism will we still have to deal with, you know, in America or in the world.
Yeah. Yeah.
But then a couple of phrases popped up in was it the father? No, it was Lord Business, I think.
Yeah.
So in the Lego movie from 2014. And you talked about a participation trophy.
Special on snowflake stuff.
Yeah, and snowflakes, yeah. And so this is specific terminology from not just right-wing talking points, but I think also, specifically kind of the toxic masculinity, whatever, the toxic culture that produced the rise of Trump in 2016 in the first place.
Just having a guy called President Business, at least at the start of it, before you know it's Lord Business,
that is sort of
prophetic because Trump took loads of his stuff that he could do as a businessman and got away with and tried to do it again as a president.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And indeed, that was kind of his appeal for so many people, from what I understand. What are you thinking when you voted for him? And then when you voted for him again?
I'm not mad. I'm just drawn that way.
He also hinted at how meta the Lego movie is, at least in his jokes. And that also sometimes just sort of rubs me the wrong way. Like, there's this
Okay.
It sometimes references stuff that I just know that the boy Finn, he couldn't have seen.
Yeah.
Which is just there for the audience's sake.
Yeah.
Like, come here if you want to not die.
Uh-huh.
I'm sure that he's not supposed to have seen the Terminator. He could have.
The 1984
I'm not gonna say he hasn't
James Cameron Terminator.
He might not be very interested in it, is more of a point to make.
Yeah. That line in particular was, I guess if you want to dissect that moment, like, what were you thinking? Even if you do get the reference, like, it's not necessarily even a joke. Come with me if you want to not die.
It's a subversion of the actual line.
Yeah, of course.
But
is it a clever twist or is it just a twist?
Yeah.
So I don't know how that joke made the cut, but fine. But it does indeed. It seems to be that it's making it clear that there was a conscious attempt, I think, to appeal to different age ranges.
Yeah. Of course, there has to be a joke in there for the grown-ups.
Yeah. I don't know. And I'm watching again, the way my kid watched it and taking notes on how he's consuming, experiencing this, this movie, this story. And I think he also got it on, multiple levels. he's seen The Matrix,
But it also tries to take these genre stereotypes and put a twist on them. That Vitruvius's prophecy is just a lie, stuff like that.
Right.
And that is, I don't mind that as a bit of storytelling.
Sure.
There is stuff with Vitruvius that I hate more, like the joke where he's being put on lookout even though he's blind. that I kind of hate it. But there's this bit of a sickness in children's cartoons where they're made by grown-up men who like to put in jokes in there for themselves sometimes too much.
Oh, for sure, yeah.
In daytime children's television, I sometimes get these cartoons where you see a protagonist of a cartoon go, oh, yes, and then, of course, you are the bad guy who does this and this and this and this. And they go through all the tropes. And I think if you're watching a cartoon for the first time and that's the one you're going into, I'm not going to say that you don't get what he's saying because you haven't seen the tropes.
Right.
I just think that you get into cartoons already cynical of all the tropes before you've seen any, and you can't see the magic of why those tropes have worked before you see them taken down a peg.
Right, yeah.
Which is more fun.
Yeah.
So you get sort of a jaded generation of kids watching cartoons.
Yeah, that's... Yeah.
But it's a bit unfair criticism because it also harks into that the whole thing of getting something and being jaded by something before you even know what they are.
Right.
Also ties into me watching, maybe this is a bit far off, maybe I should cut this, but I learned about British politics by watching Have I Got News For You. I didn't know anything about it. I just understood joke structure.
Oh, yeah.
And I got to learn about British politics by their terms, basically.
Yeah.
So I really got their point of view when I started learning about British politics, and it must have formed my opinion on that.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, well, this is, sorry, you have opened up a very interesting side line here because, I am working on, concepts for a late night comedy show or, friends who are working on them in the U.S. as well. And so ever since some statistic popped up 10 years ago or so, I think it was when Obama was becoming president, Jon Stewart was on The Daily Show. And here comes this statistic about 18 to 35-year-olds have now declared Jon Stewart as not just in their top three news sources, but their number one source of news. And Jon Stewart was upset about this at the time because he's not talking about news. He's making jokes about the news. I would argue that it's nice to have both. It's nice to have a top three. But they are, yeah, it's very informative. And there's,
yeah.
Own it.
I'm sure loads of people know the news in the Netherlands by watching Arjen Lubach.
Yeah. And yet, you know, I just talked with Janine Abring the other day about getting ready for this new season. And, you know, the Dutch politics and the Dutch campaign coming up. And maybe it will be, maybe the whole campaign or the election will be delayed. And then, you know, then what? But I guess we just talked about how difficult it is to be expected to explain things, you know, to sort of to be that number one source of news. And but I told her, all of them, basically, like, that that is your job at this point. I mean, you actually do it really well.
Yeah.
They're mini documentaries.
Yeah, I'm sure that if Comedy Central News had been canceled, but would have been a bigger success, you would have complained about your role.
Do you remember Comedy Central News? Because that's where I know news you from. Is news too. Yeah. Oh, that's great. Yeah. Oh man, what a great idea. And we did ended up doing two seasons at the same time as the news to show. The news to show, right? That was going on on the NPO, on national public television. And anyway,
Lubach was working on that, right? On
the news. Arjen Lubach was had a column on that show.
Yeah.
And anyway, I'm not sure. I think that show ended also around the same time. Hasta la vista,
baby. Maybe a bit of something that I can surprise you with. I'm going to send you, or surprise, maybe not. But I'm going to send you a screenshot of a movie that I recently watched.
Okay.
And I'd like you to
comment.
It's in the chat right now.
Oh, the chat. All right. Oh, my God. Oh, way. That's a blast from the past. Oh, my God. That is from a Dick Maas movie.
Yeah.
With me playing a feature role, I might
add.
Next
to Naomi Watts.
Next to, I've acted with Naomi Watts.
Yeah. On the on her verge of breaking through via Mulholland Drive.
Yeah. How about that for timing?
Yeah.
For and good of Dick Maas to, you know, to get to work with her before her price went way up. Oh man, and still I've written about this in my book actually, you know, that I've worked with I guess what was it, the chapter about Dutch film as a, you know, a window into the soul or culture of a. Of a country, a nationality, a culture. So, anyway, so Dick Maas as a director, I still can't wrap my head around him. Is he doing homage or parody or
in
both?
In Down?
In Down the movie as well, yeah, like specifically.
He likes schlocky B movies and he likes to make those, but there is a thing with I watched Down and I know it's supposed to be funny, but everyone is just a creep in there, including Chip, your character.
Oh God, yeah. No, I remember working with and Dick Maas and thinking like, maybe I'll finally get to the bottom of this mystery. You know, are we going for comedy here, or are we playing this, you know, as a real mystery? And he was like, no, it's serious. It's serious. Hold on. Let's get some more pizza on your mismatched. You have to be wearing a belt and suspenders. Like, okay. Yeah. So my character is like a comical character. No. It's very serious. Very serious.
Really?
Yeah.
Because I read that he sort of blamed the lead in the movie. What's his name?
James Marshall.
Twin Peaks. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
For it not really working because they weren't on equal footing about whether the movie was meant as a joke, meant serious or not.
Right.
Where James Marshall was taking it way too serious.
Oh, okay.
And Dick Maas wanted it to be a bit more jokey.
Maybe, you know, and yeah, or in
I mean, I do think that comedy often works better when it's played straight enough, at least that the character believes himself in his role.
No, I mean, on the set, from what I can recall, Dick Maas was just very efficient and straight to business. You know, great on the set, knew what he wanted. And he cast Naomi Watts. But at that point, Naomi Watts just was still working on her American accent, actually.
Yeah.
She had this broad Australian accent, you know, like we'd come out of a, you know, scene. Dick Maas would say cut, and you're like, did that sound right? I helped her with her American accent.
Cool. And you were also in Filaine Zegt Sorry?
Yeah, I played a small role in Filaine Zegt Sorry as a newscaster.
Exactly.
Well played, typecast.
You also mentioned this when you mailed me back that you one of the reasons that you came to the Netherlands was a movie called Spoorloos.
Oh, yeah.
What's the story with that?
You know, I did watch foreign movies when I was back in Chicago.
Yeah.
And way before anyone I knew was contemplating going to the Netherlands, I saw Spoorloos as a foreign film at the Fine Arts Theater in Chicago. And back then, all we knew was it was, you know, this hardcore European was maybe it was from Denmark you know, before we knew who Lars von Trier was. But that, you know, kind of mentality, it's very dark European perspective. So
actually that sentiment of is it from Denmark is very fitting in a talk about the Lego movie.
Oh, yeah? Oh, Denmark.
Lego is originally from Denmark.
Did Lars von Trier ever direct anything for the Lego brand?
That would be great.
Oh,
I would want to watch that. Yeah. All right.
Now we have to pay that off.
Yeah.
So, yeah, Spoorloos, the film. And if you haven't seen the movie, total spoilers. Boyfriend, you know, goes on a road trip with his girlfriend. They take a rest stop at like a modern tank, you know, station or gas station, and she just disappears. And he spends half the film trying to figure out what the hell happened. The police can't help him. Private investigators can't. Finally, he gets, you know, a random letter, you know, from an anonymous letter saying, I know what happened to her. And at one point, I can't tell you what happened, but I can show you. Yeah. So breathe into this or drink this or whatever.
And coffee with drugs in them.
Yeah. And then he wakes up and he finds out.
Yeah.
Cut to, you know, the end, end credits. And as an American watching that film, I was thinking like, yeah, wow. I've seen a lot of murder mysteries, but I haven't seen that ending before. That was hardcore.
But also a very cool thing of the original Spoorloos is that you follow the perpetrator for a long, in his preparations.
Right,
for
yeah.
what he's doing through a yeah. lot of the movie.
Yeah, not a crazy dude, just like a normal kind of...
makes it clear that he's a sociopath, but he has a very normal life and he acts very normally.
Everybody's got hobbies.
And... I don't mind the Lego movie being there at all. I really like that it is a thing and people enjoy it this much. Just please don't expect me to do so as well. That's basically my biggest point about the Lego movie.
That's fair.
And there is one more criticism about the thing with the instructions in the Lego movie.
Okay.
The instructions are sort of poised as a thing that's an instrument of the baddie in the film. And in the end, there is a reconciliation, like both ways of playing with Lego are valued in their own terms. Like you can be creative, you can be following the instructions, but just be your best self. That's sort of the ending, I would guess.
Yeah.
But when you see the master builders, their creativity being visualized, you see these bricks with an official part number
codes
for the brick.
Yeah.
And the thing that I associate that bit with most is with the instructions of Legos where you see the bricks with the number.
Yeah, of course. And they're all accurate, apparently.
Yeah, so the creativity is being shown like fucking instructions.
Oh, yeah. Like, yeah.
I get in a way that it's sort of like a meta thing, like, hey, I can see what they are and do that. But yeah. The thing that it reminds me of as a viewer is exactly the sort of thing that it shouldn't remind me of.
I guess
I don't want to get too hung up on this, but it did irk me.
Yeah. Oh, interesting. In a way, maybe the Lego movie was trying to create future Lego designers, you know, that you're not just looking for a wheel. You're looking for a specific size wheel, or you're not looking for a gear. You're looking for a specific, you know, number of teeth on that gear. And that is from this data series. Like, but it's funny to watch with my son, who is, you know, a builder slash master builder. But he refers to, like, oh, that one gear, like, oh, that's hard to find. They don't make that anymore. And it's interesting to watch the way my son still builds with Lego. Now, he's got some classic builds. You know, he's into the modular buildings at this point, which look like, you know, as much as possible, a real neighborhood. And they say, here's a building from this period in America, but here's also like a more European from this specific design period. And they kind of, so he's not going to, you know, he lovingly builds those and he's not going to pull them apart. No. But some of the older sets, you know, the more basic builds from, I mean, he's got now drawers and drawers and ways of sort of classifying them so that he'll spend, I mean, I think right now on a Sunday, he's upstairs watching some videos and trying to build his own DeLorean from Back to the Future.
Awesome.
Or a Porsche 911, but, you know, like the original one from the 80s. I don't know. And it's hard to build those curves. So how do you build those curves, you know, with Lego? And then you need a certain scale to da-da-da-da. Anyway, he's getting technical to the point that he does want to know what, you know, what is the data label with those specific pieces. And he's still being very much a creator, a master builder.
Yeah.
Than just a follower. And
so, yeah, I'm sure I agree that is a very intelligent way of showing the meta, the way that they see how everything is structured and what they can use for their stuff.
Yeah.
But just as a casual Lego builder, it reminds me of the wrong thing. That's what I would say is maybe not necessarily wrong with it, but just a weak spot of it.
Do you appreciate how well Lego builds were designed? I mean, if you've ever built IKEA, IKEA furniture, then you get to appreciate how well the Lego, like, part of the money you spend on a Lego kit is not just the bricks.
No, it's very much the design.
And the design of the books as well. And the way that features back into the film, subtle ways, but that my dad saved an old, build, you know, an old forklift or something that Lego expert builder, you know, that I had when I was 13, 14, and one of the last ones that I that I ever had, you know. And so, and then he gave that to me to re-gift to my kid, and he loved it so much, you know. And and it's retro, but anyway, yeah, he totally gets it. And again, like, these gears, you can't, they don't make these anymore. So these are really valuable. And once we got him a huge yellow crane set that he just built and then totally took apart and made all kinds of different weird looking stuff. And indeed, that was the moment when part of me was Lord Business, you know, like, what are you doing? You know, like, we do you know how much this thing cost? But to see the sheer amount of other stuff that he built with that deconstructed set, and he still does, like, 10 years later, like, okay.
But then you even had the man upstairs moment that is in the film where he looks at what his son has built and he starts to melt, sort of like, wow, there's some skill in this.
Right?
And it's actually quite admirable.
Yeah. 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 So, There were a couple of moments in that film.
Yeah.
But also the first discovery of your perfect place set, and then what? I've had enough of those moments as a parent as well. Like, what have you done? What? Why? What?
Improvementazio.
So, I might be a bit, I would put it a notch down on the themes of all the meta stuff in there. Some of it is good, like make the way you play Legos the point of the movie. That is brilliant piece of writing. Like, follow the instructions or be completely creative. That being the structure of the film is perfect. But some of the other stuff, like the play on movie tropes and all that, and tropes of storytelling, I could do without.
Yeah.
Loads of that.
Yeah.
Some of it okay for but not as much as there is now.
Yeah.
One thing that I would really think might be a lot better is the Lego movie should have more love for Denmark, because that's where Lego originated.
Why is that, I wonder?
Yeah, I don't know. But just a tiny nod to, yeah, Denmark is cool.
Yeah.
That would be good, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, missed opportunity.
The one before last, the improvement that I would say is, just for me personally, just not have Lord and Miller as directors. They can be writers, they can be producers. Excellent. Let them have their fun with the project. But I think I would like another director. And I think by now we would have to say that maybe Lars von Trier would have to take over.
Yeah, that would solve the would Denmark solve problem everything. As well, I guess.
Exactly. So yeah. Thanks for that.
Brilliant.
And my main thing, story-wise, that I would do different because of the thing with the logic, whether it's in the boy's head or not.
Yeah.
I would say I would maybe write out Lord Business. Not yeah. Will Ferrell, not at all, but just the things about the master plan and stuff like that
yeah.
is supposed to be in the boy's head.
Yeah.
I think you could have that as a big unknown and then just have the father influence the story by the way that goes. And
that's
then
true. Yeah.
That, I think that would improve it a bit.
Yeah.
Make it more apt, more sleek.
Yeah, interesting. And yet, the whole idea of Taco Tuesday, that has become its own kind of catchphrase, even with my uncle, who's approaching his 80s, and he just referenced Taco Tuesday is now Freedom Friday.
Yeah,
with the Biden inauguration, he said Taco Tuesday is now Freedom Friday, but still Tuesday.
And still Wednesday, because the inauguration.
But now Wednesday, yeah. Or maybe he even said, but now Wednesday. Anyway, I was like, this is an older generation than me that's quoting Lord Business? Or actually quoting Wyldstyle, but okay.
Yeah.
Okay, no, that checks out.
All right, cool. I also asked you for 3 recommendations for our listeners.
Yeah.
Tip 1.
So what have you got?
Oh, man, I've changed one since I wrote it. So I've got 3 movies from the 80s. And this is a...
is it a coincidence?
It's not a coincidence because I'm looking for older films to show to my kids as a sort of a cinema literacy project.
Okay.
And you can find films back from the 90s, even the early 90s, on DVD
or on
streaming is easier, but seems like once you get to a point of the 80s, unless they're big, Star Wars hits or something, some of these great films are really hard to find at the moment on American streaming services and stuff. But
I think that part of that is because the younger programmers who are in charge now are also, they all grew up in the 90s.
I guess. Yeah, maybe. I hadn't thought of that. Yeah.
Could be.
Well, so some gems that I would recommend from the 80s. My favorite year flies under the radar for a lot of people, but I think this was a Mel Brooks project where he did write the screenplay, did not direct it.
Okay.
And then stepped out of the way.
Fact check Norris here. The 1982 Richard Benjamin movie, My Favorite Year, was not written by Mel Brooks, though it was produced by him. The screenplay was written by Norman Steinberg and Dennis Palumbo. Fact check Norris out.
So, I think it was Richard Benjamin, who was from Northwestern University, where I went to school. So before there was Saturday Night Live, there was, what, your show of shows from the 1950s? Mm-hmm. And this was when television was live. And so Mel Brooks, I think, wrote on that show. And yeah. this was like the 30 Rock, but not a TV series. It was a film. And, you know, it's the story of that one crazy episode of your show of shows. There was Milton Berle, who was like the host, and then he would have a guest host or guest star. Yeah. And at one point, the guest star was Errol Flynn. Right. And apparently, Errol Flynn freaked out once he figured out that it was going to be live.
Yeah.
Like, I'll go on your show. But so here comes Peter O'Toole in one of his best ever roles. Okay. Lawrence of Arabia and My Favorite Year. They're both right up there. And Ratatouille. There's like,
yeah.
And so, Peter O'Toole, you know, shows up to the taping. And he says, yeah. Good news. I predict we're going to get it on the first take. Then comes the line. We always get it on the first take because it's live. Yeah. And he freaks out like, what? I'm not an actor. I'm a movie star. So that's just one of the best memorable lines. But it's just a great, well-structured screenplay and just best examples of comic heightening. And and then the ending is just it comes together in such a great twist. It's I really want to watch that again.
Tip two.
Second one, let's just go with an 80s movie from the Coen brothers, mm-hmm. and that is Raising Arizona.
Yes.
There was
Nick Cage movie.
Yeah, Nick Cage, exactly, as a cartoon character. But if you love the way that the Coen brothers love nutty dialogue, it's just a feast for the ears. You know, the Big Lebowski, you can't fully love John Goodman. in the Big Lebowski until you've seen his character in this film. And Barry Sonnenfeld was the cinematographer.
Yeah.
And it's just this operatic cinematography and the soundtrack is great. It's a quirky comedy.
Yeah. They made it after
Blood Simple.
First film. Yeah, Blood
was
Simple.
First film, yeah.
Which was more of a film noir type.
Oh, God,
They wanted to do something lighter. They did a comedy for the first time and they hit it out of the park.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's a favorite comedy for loads of other people, like Edgar Wright, film director.
Okay.
Matthew McConaughey says that he's watched that films most times in his life.
I think I've watched it. Yeah, Raising Arizona is easily, you know, because of the cinematography especially, it's watchable multiple for repeat viewings. That's true.
Yeah. Tip three.
So a third film that I and I just added is also from the 80s, and it's The Tall Guy.
Yeah. Jeff Goldblum.
And Emma Thompson.
Yeah.
And is it Richard Curtis, the director? I think well before Love Actually.
No, Mel Smith directed it, but he did write it, I think.
And Richard Curtis. So, I mean, it's that camp, of creators. You know, the classic British rom-com. And the weird thing is that I was close to being the tall guy. Like, I went and studied abroad. My first time outside the United States was in London. In 1988.
Yeah.
And the film was about an American, tall, American, Jewish-looking guy who shows up in London and ends up taking a bit part on the West End with Rowan Atkinson.
Yeah.
Who basically plays himself.
Yeah. And, a bit of a bastard version of himself.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. That's my...
It's
my
a very fun movie also with
snippet of the lit. Yeah.
The music number by Madness.
Oh, of course, it yeah. It Love. Must Be Love from Madness, the band, one of my favorite, you know, 80s bands yeah. from the time. And I'm in love with Emma Thompson. I always will be. It's weird to find a film that is so kind of like, could that have been inspired by me? Or was there someone clearly so much like me who was there just a couple years before?
You watched it and you saw yourself.
Yeah, very weird.
And you also hung out with Emma Thompson a lot. And
oh, some in some alternate universe. She's married to a Greg, isn't she?
Yeah.
I think. Because Greg after was. Kenneth Branagh, I'll never, I can't watch Kenneth Branagh movies. And I'm sure they're very good, but the way he cheated on Emma Thompson and broke up their perfect marriage, I'll never.
It ruins everything for
it
you.
It ruins, yeah. I hate his stupid face.
And so we fought and we battled, yes, we beat each other up. Both of us tried hard, but we both failed. Yes, I had you by the thumbs, but neither of us won. Only the love for cinema prevailed.
That's it. Thank you for listening. And of course, a very big thanks to Greg Shapiro for being willing to call in on a date on which he was supposed to be a Nijmegen. I hope you have a great time on the 7th of March when you are performing here at the Tiemeloods. Greg Shapiro, the American Netherlander. Book title! Now, have I seen anything nice these last 2 weeks? Of course I have. I finally watched Shampoo, a Hal Ashby classic from the 70s. It stars Warren Beatty as a hairdresser who gets into all kinds of lovers' trysts, set against the background of the election night where Richard Nixon got elected for the first time. It didn't really make me laugh, but it's still definitely a comedy. Maybe even a satire. A title that doesn't need much explanation, I think, but I'm still going to say that I watched it and liked it, is Ford v. Ferrari, or Le Mans 66, the other title on which it is known. And last time I think I mentioned Mangrove, the first part of Steve McQueen's Small Axe series. I watched the rest of them in the meantime, and I think my favorite one could be Education. That's the one that gave me the most tears in the end, although there is also a lot to say for Lover's Rock. Actually, you should just watch the whole series. They're all great. But Education, it really touched me in a way that other episodes from Small Axe didn't. So what else is there to say? This has been a cinema production. It has been edited and presented by me, Ruud, de 20ste Eeuwse Vos. And all the jingles are by the genius, that is, Roy Grutters. It has been made possible by my patrons, Casey the Great, Onno Lubbers, and of course, Edwin. And if you would like to join them in supporting this podcast, please visit patreon.com/duimpjewasselen and find out how. You can find us on the social media. Of course, Twitter, Instagram and Facebook. And if you want to leave us a hate mail, you can do so at duimpjewasselen@gmail.com. Anyway, that is it for this time. See you again in 2 weeks. And of course, een hele dikke doei.
Ladies and gentlemen, could we have an enormous round of applause, please, for our host, who has once again succeeded in bringing to us a plethora of top-notch, cinematographically-themed entertainment. We have had an absolute ball, have we not? Next time on Thumb Wrestling.
Dit allemaal zeggende weet ik gewoon dat al mijn filmmakende vriendjes straks deze podcast gaan luisteren en mij allemaal gaan bellen zo van, je weet niet waar je het over hebt. Waar gaat het over? En waarschijnlijk nooit met me willen werken. Sorry jongens.
This podcast employees is strict. Only like and subscribe if you really want to. Policy. Okay, bye.